swimming was first introduced to me by my swimming coach, Miss Irene Hisham. She was the one who was explaining about coding to my parents and recommended QT kits to them to enroll me to start my coding journey. My dad, who was very keen with her explanation, came home and talked to me about it. Me, who really likes to play games and spend a lot of time on my laptop, said yes and thought it was a very good idea because it will help me in my future to code or create my own game or website.
My favorite part about coding is when I get to test the project I have made so I can see it's either successful or unsuccessful. And if it's unsuccessful, I could improve my troubleshooting skill too.
Yeah, I will use it for my future career maybe so I can like be really good at coding than most country or university want to accept me as their coder, or maybe I can help people edit their photos or, you know, code new games and post it on the app store, and then people will like my game and I'll become more popular.
Our vision is to discover an individual's passion and turn it into sustainable skills. Therefore, we have catered to curriculum best fit for kindergartens, primary and secondary school students. We shall learn and master future-ready skills such as artificial intelligence, robotics, coding, 3D modeling, and so on.
Red. Orange. Yellow.
In future, most of the job will be replaced by robots, machines, and software. Here comes questions. Will robots take over humans? Definitely no. But we must undergo a transformation, reshape education, and reform ourselves. We foster the unique individualities and self-assurance of each student, equipping them to take on the world with our genius tech philosophy, one patient's infinite future.
Welcome back to the afternoon session of Day 3 of the My Digital Maker Fair 2022 at East Malaysia. I hope everyone's had their lunch and is raring to go again with a few more amazing sessions happening all the way to 5 p.m. So do stay with us. We've got three more sessions. Obviously, one is coming up immediately in right now. We've had two great sessions today already. First in the morning with Vincent Koch of Microsoft, his tips and sharing of his experience going through the interview process to land a job at Microsoft is definitely great. At 12 noon earlier, we had such an amazing conversation with the inaugural winner of the Malaysia Teacher Prize Award, Cikgu Anutra Sirisena. She's also the founder of the impact-driven Ternom Innovation Center. Our next guest today, who will be doing a little bit of sharing, is Cikgu Auzellea Kristin Mozihim. I have been told to address her as Cikgu Zell throughout this conversation later. She is a teacher at SMK Bongawan Papar Sabah. Welcome to the show, Cikgu Zell. How are you?
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you for having me. Yeah.
Great to have you. Obviously, you know, how is the weather like in Sabah? Are you able to see Mount Kinabalu today from where you are?
Not really, but the weather is okay. Yeah, so far it's okay. Yeah.
Great, great, great. So we will get to Bongawan Papar, SMK Bongawan Papar in a short while. But first of all, on behalf of Synapse and MDEC, we would like to welcome you to the My Digital Maker Fair 2022 at East Malaysia, and also to thank you for spending your Sunday with us and sharing some of your knowledge on the topic that we have today. Obviously, we are going to be touching about soft skills, whether or not it's integral in the tech industry. I want to kick-start the conversation by perhaps getting Cikgu Zell to introduce herself and to also give us a little background in terms of her teaching career. So please go ahead, Cikgu Zell.
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Auzellea Kristin Mozihim, but please call me Cikgu Zell. I'm an English teacher. I'm currently teaching at SMK Bongawan Papar Sabah. I've been teaching for, this year is my seventh year, but SMK Bongawan is my second school. My first school was at SMK Terusan Sugut, Baluran. Yeah.
And how long have you been teaching at Bongawan?
Oh, I got transferred in March, so it's been 9 months.
Okay.
7 months. Yeah.
A couple of months. All right.
Yeah.
Perhaps give us an idea of how that school is like. How many students do you roughly have? And do they even have things like RBK or ASK, for example, ASA Science Computer, for example?
Yes. Okay. So that school, we have about 800. Students. And yeah, we do have SK, and recently my school, we have a few of the students participated in a STEM related competition which was organized recently by UMS, University of Malaysia Sabah. And the student, they won first prize.
Wow. Yeah, fantastic. Fantastic.
Yeah.
That is extremely congratulations to the school and to the teachers and to the students involved as well. Very nice. Now, like Cikgu Anutra in the session before this, you are also a Teaching and Excellence Achievement Program Fulbright Scholar. Fulbright TA program, of course, brings international teachers to the United States for a six-week program to take academic seminars for professionals development at a host university and to observe and share their expertise with teachers and students at the host university and a local secondary school. Could you share with us that experience with, how did you end up registering for it? How was the process like? And that whole experience of completing the program.
Yeah. Okay, so at first I did not know anything about this program until a teacher friend, but I only know her through Instagram. She shared about the open for applications. So I decided to just try it out because at that time I wanted to experience something new. So I guess the Fulbright program is something that is worth trying for. And then I applied for it. I went to the website, looked at all the eligibility criteria and what is needed to be filled in, like your personal statements and also your asking for a leave approval and so on and so forth. And then, the process, it took me about 3 months, I guess. Yeah, it opened in December. And it closed at March, so it took me about, because I needed to focus on the application process, which was the personal statement part. There were several questions that were asking the applicants to answer related to their teaching background, the students, demographic, and so on. And then, of course, I did not do it on my own. I needed help from alumni. So I got advice from alumni. I asked them how should I frame this my essay, how should I frame these essays, and then after that I applied, I submitted the application, and then I received an interview. Okay, so the interview, it was, at first I did not think I would get it because I was there was one question that was I did not know how to really answer it, but it just came on top of my head and I went with it. I started during that interview, but luckily I got selected, and I had to go for TOEFL test, and then I had to do my passport and all the process whereby when you have to leave the country and all that.
Yep.
I have to go to the US embassy. I had to fly from Sabah to KL just to do the visa. Yeah. Okay, that was before I arrived in the United States. So when I arrived in the United States, in that classroom, there were 14 nationalities, 16 teachers, but 14 nationalities, because there were two from Egypt and two from Malaysia. From Malaysia. So it was one, me, and the other one was a STEM teacher, but we were in the same class. We were at Florida Gulf Coast University. And so, yeah, the experience was there are two things from that experience, from that program. The first one was I get to interact with people from different cultures. And then, despite having read about these cultures, you know, in books and in the media, it's very different when you interact with them face to face, like they're in front of you. Yeah, and then, of course, at that time, there's this thing called global competence. Global competence meaning it's the ability to communicate with people from other cultures, because, you know, for example, like Malaysia or Asians in general, we are different from the West in general. And then the second thing was we had a project-based learning module. It's a program where we the teachers, the participants of that program, we have to participate in a project-based learning rather than facilitating a project-based learning. So we were like the students. So that was the one of the modules that really is the thing that I really want to apply back when I come back to Malaysia. I want to apply that in my school for my students. So those are the two things. First one is learning to interact with people from different cultures. And the second one is the project-based learning approach. Yeah.
Great. So you did mention there was another Malaysian together with you as well, and eventually your cohort is the size of 16 people, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I would assume it's a literally a full-time thing, right? During that 6 weeks, a lot of activities and a lot of, I suppose, attending classes and lectures or site visits and whatnot are all crammed into that 6 weeks. Would you recommend this program to other teachers to perhaps give it a try?
Yes, of course. Because it really, well, from my personal experience, before I went there, the thing about global competence is not really familiar to me. And then when I got there, I realized, okay, so this is what it means to have global competence skills, because you're going to work with people from other cultures, and then sometimes there are intercultural clashes that you need to accommodate and try to understand why this person is acting this way. You know, it's either personality, context, a culture, or situation. So you have to like really think about it and be tactful. And then, the first one is because you get to learn about other cultures, because in this day and age, you know, globalization is happening. So we cannot be like just focused on our own people or our own cultures. We need to learn from other cultures as well. And then also during that program, I get to go to a school. I get to go to a school site visits for 2 weeks. It's a middle school. Yeah. So I went there and I observed the teacher, and then I get to, well, anybody who has the chance to go there, you get to like compare the education system between the US and Malaysia. There are a lot of differences, even though both are, you know, US and Malaysia, they're both federal systems, but the education system are totally different. So I get to mentally compare, you know. And also, yeah, we have excursions. We went to Miami, because our program was at Fort Myers. It's 2 hours away from Miami. So I get to go to Miami, which is the third largest city in the United States, for free. And then, yeah, I get to explore with the other fellows. Yeah, we had fun. There's fun, and there's, of course, we're busy busy and fun and work at the same time for all those 6 weeks, because it felt like 6 months. Personally, I felt it felt like 6 months because we were too busy, but it's worthwhile. Yeah.
Now, our viewers might be wondering why am I talking about the program, the scholarship, and as well as asking you about the experience.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Here.
It's you're muted. Sorry.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. So as I was saying, I was telling my I was just saying that there's a reason why I'm asking you to share all this with our viewers today, because it's a nice lead up to our topic today, which is talking about soft skills, right? And technically, you know, knowingly or unknowingly, you have already mentioned some of the soft skills that is required during your program. And I want to stress upon here that whether it's for any industries, for that matter, soft skills is very, very important, right? We talk about, for example, we talk about tech. Obviously, there's that fear of robots and AI and automation taking over our jobs and whatnot. But I think the human factor, the human soft skills are still very needed, you know, in the tech industry. We talk about soft skills, usually attributed to personal attributes needed to be successful in a job or role, right? Time management, teamwork, networking, creative thinking. You spoke about, you know, having to understand different cultures and different backgrounds, and even in Malaysia for that matter. And I'm sure also in East Malaysia, there are so many different cultures to understand in that sense. So those kind of soft skills are definitely important. And I would like to also throw in empathy, and hopefully you can talk a little bit about empathy as well, in a working landscape. Now, what are your thoughts, Cikgu Zell, when you looked at the topic soft skills now, do you think it's relevant for the tech space?
Yes, it is very relevant. Well, firstly, we all in schools, for example, we unknowingly or knowingly, we cultivate soft skills among the students. Like, for example, because of course in schools we have this thing called 21st century skills, and a few of the 21st century skills are actually soft skills that are needed for students to, you know, be successful once they go to university and work. A few of the skills were, for example, like critical thinking, creativity, collaboration, and communication. These are all important skills. Like, okay, so we relate it back to tech. You know, maybe these students in the future, they will get involved in the tech industry. But in order for you to be successful in tech, first of all, you need all of these soft skills. For example, like empathy, because you will be working with people and you don't want to have a toxic environment. First of all, in a working environment, you know, if you are in tech industry, you don't want to have a toxic environment, so that's why you need to learn empathy. Otherwise, if you have a goal to achieve in terms of any tech projects, you know, but you're not that well liked by your colleagues, you know, and these colleagues are important for you to collaborate. Collaboration, another soft skill, so that your project will become successful, for example. So of course, soft skills, they are very relevant. And then of course, communication as in previously I mentioned about global competence. So global competence, one of the things is communication, our communication style. You know, when I understand that in tech industries we tend to collaborate with tech industries from overseas, not only within our own country, but also, you know, there's a possibility to collaborate with tech organizations from overseas. So when we are gonna collaborate with them, people from other countries, so you gotta have these global competence skills. So for example, you gotta understand whether these particular culture, are they high context or low context?
Yeah.
So for example, in Malaysia, generally we are high context. Our communication style is high context. So for example, if you wanna collaborate with people from a low context background, how would you actually communicate with them? Because if we don't understand from their point of view, or or practice a suitable communication skill with them, there's gonna be, you know, collaboration won't happen, and that whatever development you want to do in tech won't happen, you know. So that's why one of the things is global competence skills as well, in terms of communication and knowing how to navigate oneself when communicating, not only with people in your own country, but also from other countries as well. And then another thing is, of course, these two, they are quite important. There are also other things as well. Like, for example, like teamwork is part of collaboration. And then time management, of course, if you don't know how to manage your time, you will waste other people's time, you know, and that's not gonna be healthy for the organization, for the particular tech organization. And project management, that's one of the things as well. If you don't know how to manage the project well, it won't go well. So basically, these are all, they overlap and interrelated, you know.
Correct.
One thing is related to another, or one thing leads to another, you know.
I totally agree with you, Cheguzel, when you talked about time management. You know, in the tech space, I repeated this earlier as well in an earlier session. Whatever that is new today, as in, if it's a new tech today, tomorrow it could be obsolete because someone else would probably think of a better way of presenting that technology. So time management is very crucial. You brought up a very good point when you talk about global competencies, because it's needed in a lot of collaboration today, not just within Malaysia and Malaysians, but also with a global audience, right? And I think what the pandemic has taught us over the last 2.5 years is that global collaboration is literally at our fingertips, right? In fact, in a way, we are almost collaborating across the sea, because you are right there in Papua Sabah and we are here in Kuala Lumpur. So, you know, we are not at the same place at the same time, technically. So that's how global collaboration has been really happening over the last 2.5 years. So it's really important for people to understand that. Communication, yes, project management, you know, it overlaps for sure. But again, it overlaps in different degrees, I suppose. And that's how we need to work closely in that sense. Very, very interesting. Now, how do you see soft skills coming in when we talk about entrepreneurship, we talk about technopreneurship, especially for tech people, right? Where do you see that coming in? I mean, in off the top of my head, I can think of things like, you know, presentation skills to potential investors, business partners, future users, consumers, community, even to authorities, right? Or to, you know, perhaps future buyers or clients in that manner. How do you see that fitting in? I suppose my question to you would be this. Yes, in school today, there is a lot of ASK, Asa Science Computer. There is a lot of RBK as well, Reka Bentuk Science, Reka Bentuk Computer and all that. Those are the hard skills, teaching you the coding, the programming, you know, teaching you how to literally fly the drones and whatnot. But do you think soft skills should come in and be part and parcel of that curriculum as well for STEM?
Yes, definitely. Like I said before, we have the 21st century skills. This one is, among teachers, we are very familiar with this. We've been taught about this, you know, in our professional development courses and whatnot. So so one of the soft skills are, not only they are like learning skills, literacy skills, and life skills. I guess these are the sub soft skills. So one of them is, for example, like presentation skills. Mm-hmm. You gotta, when you present, let me refer to project-based learning. For project-based learning, we have, at the end of the project, the students, they need to present. And when they present, not only in terms of their tone of voice, but also their body language, and also the what they present. Like if they're using a PowerPoint, is it eye-catching or is it too wordy? Those things they have to take into account. So when we teachers at the school level, we should train them in these aspects, so that when they know that when they go out, you know, if they want to be an entrepreneur, you know, or technopreneur, they already have this in their minds that when you present something to future buyers or stakeholders,
yes,
when you do presentations, you need to don't be so wordy on the PowerPoint and maybe have interesting graphics, you know, those kinds of basic things. So even in school, we can already tell the students, okay, when you do presentation, it should not be wordy. Because that's what I did with my students. I'm currently doing it with my students. It's project-based learning. It's not tech, but still there's soft skills involved. Like, for example, presentation skills. I told them, do not copy everything that you wrote on the... Because they have to write a report. And that report, they just have to transfer it to a presentation. But don't copy everything. Make it beautiful. Make it simple. That's what I told them. And I have to guide them as well on how to do it. Otherwise, you know, people who are listening to them, the audience, they will feel bored. And so, so of course, it is very, they are relevant. And it should, of course, it should start at the school level. And teachers need to always give opportunity to students to present so that they can, you know, get used to it.
It's funny you brought up that last point, because it was something that was playing in my head and I wanted to ask, you know, in the school that you're teaching and obviously your direct students that you are also teaching as well, do they have any problems presenting to you or to a school or if it's a state level competition and whatnot, do they have issues in terms of coming up to present? Do they find it difficult? Are they still shy? Do they think their language proficiency is not that great?
Yeah, well, there are a few students in my class. There was one class. Well, you know, students, they have different personalities. They have different levels of confidence. Some of them, yes, they are quite shy. Some of them, they are quite confident. But yeah, that's the thing, you know, because I teach this particular class is like, they are 15-year-olds, form three, but I encourage them to present. The presentation will be happening next week, you know, and I'm going to invite my principal to watch. So of course, before that, I tell them, all of you students, I know some of you are shy, but you gotta try not to, just be confident. That's why before the presentation, the actual presentation day, I have a practice session with them. So it's good so that they can build that confidence even before the real presentation. So teachers, that we need to understand that. So this is empathy, right? We have to understand that some students, they are not confident enough. So that's why we need to guide them. We want them to be leaders, future leaders. We want them to be confident. So that's why we as the teachers, we need to guide them. Guide them as in like not only tell them but watch them do it.
So a lot of practice needs to be in place, you know, for anyone for that matter to sharpen their soft skills in that sense. I totally agree with you. So that's great. You mentioned briefly about in 2 weeks' time, or was it next week, you have a presentation with your students. I was going to ask you actually, what are you currently working on with your school first, and then perhaps on a larger context within your community or within the Fulbright alumni, is there anything that's ongoing that you would like to share with us? You know, I'm sure you are always on the go and having a lot of exciting things, you know, working on the site as well. Do share with us.
Yeah. So after coming back from the Fulbright program, I wanted to do something related to international collaboration. But at first, I did not know what is it yet, you know. And then suddenly, it came into my mind that since I am the highly HIP coordinator, highly immersive program coordinator for my school, it's basically a program that encourages students and also teachers to converse in English. Yeah, so it's a whole school approach. So I did, in May, I did one webinar with one of the Russian fellows. I met met her at the Fulbright program. So I decided to do a webinar on just talking about school culture, schooling culture between Malaysia and Russia. So there's a we learned about the differences. And then recently, just last month, I mean, this one is, it went for 1 month. Yeah, the program was for 1 month. We did a, I call it a the journal swap for global competence project. So this in this project, it involved 25 of my Form 3 students. They, firstly, there were three phases of that project. So the first one is, they write journals, they write their journal entries for 7 days. Okay, after that, after they have done writing, we swap them. We swap them with their Russian counterparts. So the Russians, they read about the Malaysians, they read about the Russians.
Right.
Yeah. And then that's the second phase. And then the third phase, we did a Zoom session, video conferencing on Zoom. They get to interact, authentically interact in English with their Russian counterparts, learning about Russian culture, the school system, and also their Russian peers' personal life. The same goes for the Russians. So it's a so it's part and parcel of what I aim to do. You know, global competence, global citizenship. I wanted my students, because I experienced that in the US. Of course, it was physical. It was a physical program. But for this one, I could not. I was not able to do physical with the with them. But online is still. They find it fun, and they wanted more of it. You know, because the program, the session was only 1 hour. Some of them, they wanted it to be more than 1 hour. Yeah. So maybe I will try it for the next cohort of students. But maybe with different countries. Yeah.
Yeah, so that's interesting. I was just going to ask if there are plans to do it with your other alumni within your cohort, because you mentioned Egypt and several other countries as well, right? So it would be fantastic to follow on that progress, Cikgu Zell, and see more of your students, you know, being confident enough to speak to their counterparts or their peers in different parts of the world as well. Now, I want to ask, in terms of English proficiency in your school currently, perhaps at the very early stage of you joining until today, do you think their English proficiency or do you think their understanding of the English language has improved? And you know, do you think project-based kind of learning is really the way forward in terms of really getting them hands-on experience in that sense?
Yes. So when I first joined the school, I think it's very different from my previous school. They can understand. At least they can understand when I teach them. At least they can understand. But of course, there needs to be more practice in terms of language production.
Yep.
Yeah, as in writing and speaking. So that's why with this project, like project-based learning, I'm doing more on writing part and also the speaking part. So through that project-based learning that I'm doing, they get to practice the writing, and also by presenting is the speaking part. They get to practice the speaking part. It's a, it's not a, you know, overnight success. You know, there's a lot to be done. Yeah. So this is like my first. Actually, I already did with two classes. My the PBL project I already did with two classes. The first one was with my Form 4, and the other one is my Form 3, the currently ongoing one.
Yeah.
So from there, I know how to, I will look at the level of proficiency in terms of their writing and also their speaking. So that is where I will know that, okay, what needs to be done? What needs to be improved? Yeah, of course, they're still learning, so give them time, you know, but also at the same time, we guide them.
Fantastic. You know, Cikgu Zell, the stuff that you do is really, you know, out of the box. You've brought in your experience in terms of being in the program and then imparting it to the students as well by giving them real hands-on experience in terms of doing a global collaboration. So that's fantastic. Now, if any of the teachers out there who are interested to find out more about the Fulbright program, you know, MACI makes it possible in Malaysia. So in the MACI is the Malaysian American Commission on Educational Exchange, which was founded in 1963 as a binational commission for Malaysia and the United States to promote educational exchange between two countries. So if the QR code is there, please scan on it, and then you will be able to find more about the TEA program, the Teaching Excellence and Achievement program. I think the closing date for 2023 is actually on December 22nd. So that will be not very far away, and like what Cikgu Zell said, it will need to be you will need to take some time to fill up the forms and do all the essays and stuff like that. So it would be great if any of you who are listening in or who are tuning in later, if you're interested, please go to their website and find out more information. I think Cikgu Zell is a very good example of how you can make full use and leverage on that experience and impart it back to the students as well. So that's really great. Once again, Cikgu Zell, we have come towards the end of our time. We do have another session at 3 p.m. So again, I think we both agree soft skills definitely needed, not just in the tech industry, but any industry across the spectrum, and we also hope that language, things like empathy, time management and project management will be the basis for STEM students here to take on as they move towards a career where they see themselves as technopreneurs. So thank you once again, Cikgu Zell, for that very short and sweet sharing, but very insightful as well. We value your time. We truly appreciate you coming over on a Sunday afternoon. Thank you so much for being with us. Ladies and gentlemen, don't go away. We will be moving to our next guest at 3 p.m. where we will be welcoming Cikgu Shamsuria into the mix, and closing off at 4 p.m. With Associate Professor Technologist Dr. Helmi, with his sharing on iOS mobile app ideation. So stay tuned, ladies and gentlemen. And once again, Cikgu Zell, thank you so much for your time. We'll see you again. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you for having me.
Coding was first introduced to me by my swimming coach, Miss Irene Hisham. She was the one who was explaining about coding to my parents and recommended QT kits to them to enroll me to start my coding journey. My dad, who was very keen with her explanation, came home and talked to me about it. Me, who really likes to play games and spend a lot of time on my laptop, said yes and thought it was a very good idea because it will help me in my future to code or create my own game or website.
My favorite part about coding is when I get to test the project I have made so I can see it's either successful or unsuccessful. And if it's unsuccessful, I could improve my troubleshooting skill too.
Yeah, I'll use it for my future career maybe so I can be really good at coding, then most country or university want to accept me as their coder, or maybe I can help people edit their photos or code new games and post it on the app store, and then people will like my game and I'll become more popular.
Our vision is to discover an individual's passion and turn it into sustainable skills. Therefore, we have catered to curriculum best fit for kindergartens, primary and secondary school students. We shall learn and master future-ready skills such as artificial intelligence, robotics, coding, 3D modeling, and so on.
Red. Orange. Yellow.
In future, most of the job will be replaced by robots, machines, and software. Here comes questions. Will robots take over humans? Definitely no. But we must undergo a transformation, reshape education, and reform ourselves. We foster the unique individualities and self-assurance of each student, equipping them to take on the world with our genius tech philosophy, one patient's infinite future.
Welcome everybody to Edu360 Academy.
E-At Robot Club is a one-stop STEAM robotics coding learning center in Malaysia. We provide robotics education to students from ages 6 to 16. We adopted Korea and use a robotics teaching module. It is carefully crafted to fit the students' needs in Malaysia. E-At Robot Club is certified by Digital Maker Hub and My Digital Maker since 2018. Since 2018, our annual national robotics competition are recognized by the Ministry of Education, which is known as STEAM Cup Malaysia. Our headquarters is located at Emporis Kota Damansara. We provide a nurturing, stimulating, and safe environment for our students, facilitated with PC, equipment, 3D printing, and maker lab. As for today, we have more than 30 E-At Robot Club learning centers throughout Malaysia. We educate our students not only through assembling robots, but we focus on practical use of mechanical parts, programming learning, and project management. We emphasize students' growth to ensure the technology we educate them could be beneficial and help them to achieve success in their future.
Selamat kembali ke Siri Microbit. Saya Alina dan perkenalkan rakan saya, Si Kura-Kura. Untuk video kali ini, kita akan gabungkan beberapa perkara yang kita telah pun belajar daripada video yang lepas. Kita akan gunakan pemboleh ubah atau variable dalam pengaturcaraan kita. Pemboleh ubah ialah ruang simpanan sementara untuk nombor, teks dan objek. Nilai ini boleh disimpan untuk digunakan kemudian. Sediakan semua bahan projek dulu. Kertas kardbord, botol air dan papan microbit. Potong bentuk kura-kura daripada kardbord. Gunakan botol air plastik sebagai cengkerang kura-kura. Sediakan ruang untuk keluarkan kepala kura-kura nanti. Kali ini, kita nak programkan microbit untuk paparkan bilangan kali kita menggoncang kura-kura. Pada perisian make code, isytiharkan pemboleh ubah di bawah laci blok variable. Tekan make a variable dan berikan nama yang sesuai untuk pemboleh ubah. Type kiraan. On start, masukkan blok set kiraan to 0. Tekan input dan tekan on shake. Masukkan blok change kiraan by 1. Atau cara ini akan menukar pemboleh ubah kiraan setiap kali microbit digoncang. Untuk memamparkan kiraan tersebut, gunakan blok forever dan masukkan blok show number. Tekan variable dan pilih kiraan untuk dimasukkan dalam blok show number. Sambungkan microbit pada komputer dengan menggunakan wire USB. Tekan download pada perisian dan savekan fail atau cara ke dalam microbit. Perhatikan apa yang berlaku apabila microbit digoncang. Kiraan akan berubah mengikut goncangan saya. Projek kura-kura belum siap lagi. Untuk video seterusnya, kita akan pasangkan servo motor untuk keluarkan kepala kura-kura apabila digoncang. Sebagai cabaran, cuba kembalikan nilai pemboleh ubah kiraan kepada kosong apabila salah satu butang ditekan. Selamat mencuba! Selamat kembali ke Siri Microbit. Saya Alina dan hari ini kita nak habiskan projek kura-kura kita. Di video lepas, kita telah gunakan pemboleh ubah untuk mengira bilangan goncangan. Kali ini, kita nak tambah servo motor untuk keluarkan kepala kura-kura apabila microbit digoncang. Sediakan semua bahan-bahan projek seperti video yang lepas. Cuma kita tambah wire penyambung, micro servo motor 3 volt, 3 clip wire, bekalan kuasa atau bateri. Potong botol air plastik untuk jadikan cengkerang kura-kura. Pastikan lubang untuk microbit boleh dipaparkan dan kepala kura-kura boleh keluar. Potong kepala kura-kura. pasangkan lengan pada servo motor, skru dengan ketat, dan gamkan lengan tersebut kepada kepala kura-kura tadi. Sambungkan wayar penyambung dengan servo motor, wayar putih dengan wayar tinta, wayar merah dengan wayar merah dan wayar coklat ke wayar hitam. Klipkan wayar berwarna putih pada pin kosong. Wayar berwarna hitam pada GND. Dan wayar merah ke 3 volt. Video kali ini, kita akan cuba program microbit untuk mengeluarkan kepala kura-kura apabila microbit telah digoncang sekurang-kurangnya 5 kali. Kita perlu menggunakan struktur kawalan pilihan tunggal atau single choice conditional. Kita boleh menggunakan blok kumpulan logik untuk melaksanakan struktur kawalan pilihan tunggal. Kita gunakan blok if then. Jika syarat dipenuhi, blok yang terkandung dalam blok pilihan akan dilaksanakan. Syarat boleh ditetapkan dengan menggunakan blok perbandingan. Jika perbandingan adalah benar, blok ini akan menjalankan blok-blok atau cara di bawahnya. Untuk projek ini, kita tetapkan kiraan lebih besar atau sama dengan 5. Kita masukkan atau cara servo motor di dalam blok pilihan tersebut. Set servo P0, angle to 90 darjah. Tambah blok P0, angle to 0 darjah. Tambah blok pause untuk 500 milisaat. Ulang blok-blok ini untuk kembalikan servo motor pada posisi asal. Sambungkan microbit pada komputer dengan menggunakan wayar USB. Tekan download pada perisian dan savekan fail atau cara ke dalam microbit. Keluarkan wayar USB daripada microbit. Sambung bekalan kuasa atau bateri kepada microbit. On bekalan kuasa dan perhatikan apa yang berlaku apabila microbit digoncang. Goncangan pertama. Kepala kura-kura hanya akan keluar jika microbit digoncang sekurang-kurangnya 5 kali. Kemaskan projek anda dan cuba susunkan wayar dan papan microbit supaya tidak kelihatan dari depan. Projek kura-kura anda dah siap. Sebagai cabaran, cuba keluarkan kepala kura-kura jika digoncang selama 5 kali dan masukkan semula kura-kura jika kura-kura digoncang 7 kali. Programkan microbit anda untuk reset kiraan apabila butang ditekan. Selamat mencuba.
Bertemu kembali kami di My Digital Maker Fair 2022 at East Malaysia. Terima kasih kerana masih bersama-sama dengan kami di hari yang ketiga dan hari yang begitu padat sekali. Dah ada tiga sesi yang telah berlalu dan ada dua sesi yang akan berlangsung selepas ini. Banyak perkongsian yang telah dibuat oleh tetamu-tetamu kami dan sebagainya. Lebih dikenali sebagai Cikgu Syam, Cikgu Shamsuria Ebni merupakan seorang guru besar di Sekolah Kebangsaan Layang-Layangan, Wilayah Persekutuan Labuan. Orang Sarawak tetapi bekerja di Labuan, sudah mempunyai 23 tahun pengalaman mengajar. Lama ya, memang otai. Dan juga merupakan Cikgu Juara Digital 2022, top 5 dalam kategori pentadbir. Dan Cikgu Syam juga merupakan leader di Google Educator Group Labuan. Jadi tanpa melengahkan masa lagi, mari kita menjemput Cikgu Syam. Cikgu Syam, apa khabar?
Alhamdulillah.
Bagus. Terima kasih kerana telah meluangkan masa bersama kami di My Digital Maker 2022 at East Malaysia, ya, Cikgu Syam. Bagi pihak Synapse dan juga pihak MDEC, kami mengucapkan ribuan terima kasihlah kepada Cikgu kerana sudi untuk hari ini berkongsi mengenai program Google Educator. Jadi saya tidak mahu mengambil masa Cikgu lagi. Saya dengan seterusnya memberikan ruang ini kepada Cikgu untuk membuat perkongsian. Silakan.
Terima kasih, Nurul. Okey, terima kasih. Assalamualaikum dan selamat sejahtera saya ucapkan kepada semua. Seperti yang telah diperkenalkan tadi, saya merupakan skill yang baru saja. Saya baru dan sebenarnya saya merupakan guru sains sekolah rendah dan saya sebelum ni pernah berkhidmat di SK Karaga Saranau, Sabah. Orang Sabah rasanya tahu ni di mana Karaga Saranau ni. Dan saya rasa ada mungkin orang Sabah sendiri yang tak pernah lagi sampai ke ke SK Karaga Saranau ni. Dia kawasan yang pedalaman sikit. Okay, lepas tu saya berkhidmat di SK SNN dan ditukarkan ke SK Ranca-Ranca. Dan baru-baru ni saya dipindahkan ke SK Layangan sebagai seorang guru besar. Macam yang tertera pada slide saya ni, saya merupakan certified untuk certified untuk level 1, level 2 dan saya merupakan seorang trainer lah. Okey, seterusnya saya nampak ramai sudah geng-geng GEG, geng-geng CGD yang join petang ni. Terima kasih atas sokongan dan antara anugerah yang saya pernah dapat lah. Dan selain daripada itu, selain daripada dikenali sebagai Cikgu Syam, saya juga dikenali sebagai Cikgu Gincu Merah. Okay. Seperti yang dimaklumkan oleh Andrew tadi, saya merupakan top 5. Itu anugerah yang terbaru saya dapat tahun inilah, iaitu kategori pentadbir untuk CGD 2022 ini. Dan saya merupakan salah seorang daripada 5 influencer semasa PKP itu. Okay, dan merupakan ikon pendidikan maya wilayah Pusat Labuan. Dan ikon STEM untuk wilayah Persekutuan Labuan. Itu sebab sedikit lah. Ini gambar saya semasa saya terima anugerah semasa hari guru baru-baru ni lah. Okay. Saya nak cerita sedikit lah sebelum saya cerita lebih lanjut pasal Google Educator, Certified Educator ni. Kenapa saya keluarkan gambar ni? Ini kerana nampak tak saya kecil je kat tengah dekat dua orang tu. Okay, sebenarnya saya nak berterima kasih in personal lah kepada dua orang ini di mana mereka inilah yang telah menjerumuskan saya ke dalam bidang GEG ni lah. Di mana Cikgu Zaf dan Cikgu Ustaz ini semasa PKP saya dah kenal lama Cikgu Zaf sebagai guru sains tetapi Ustaz D saya kenal semasa PKP di mana masa itu saya turning point bagi diri saya bagaimana saya boleh terlibat dengan sebab masa sebelum ni saya nak terus terang saya dulu tak ada email Google pun saya tak ada. Saya masih pengguna setia Yahoo, email Yahoo. Tapi disebabkan masa PKP tu macam saya cakap tadi adalah turning point kepada saya di mana di situlah bermulanya inilah dua orang yang bertanggungjawab ni. Yang telah mendedahkan saya kepada banyak kelebihan apa masa ini. Okay, untuk petang ni, saya akan cerita sedikit tentang pengenalan dan selepas tu saya akan berkongsi serba sedikit kerja buat Cikgu Shamsuria sebagai seorang pentadbir menggunakan produk Google. Dan nilai tambah yang Google ini kepada pentadbir sekolah khasnya, sebab saya petang ini ingin bercerita tentang positif indicator ni di kacamata seorang pentadbir lah. Kebetulan saya pun baru dilantik jadi GP besar, jadi saya ingin bercerita tentang kebaikan benda ni, nilai tambah perkara nombor tiga nantilah, nilai tambah kepada pentadbir sekolah dan bagaimana kita nak menyertai GEG, kumpulan community ni, okay, community Google ni untuk cikgu dapatkan bantuan. Dan seterusnya saya akan terangkan sedikit tentang format ujian sebab ramai yang tanya macam mana format ujian ni. Okay, dan akhir sekali saya akan bagi cikgu satu Google form. Cikgu mohonlah untuk berminat, sesiapa yang berminat bagi, nak mendapatkan voucher percuma untuk TCE level 1. Kalau dapat free buat apa nak bayar kan? Macam itulah lebih kurang. So saya teruskan dengan kalau kita tengok, saya nak tanya lah siapa reply adakah anda pengguna tega produk Google? Kita ada banyak produk Google dekat dekat dalam apps apps yang menggunakan produk Google. Dan tolong nyatakan cikgu pengguna tega yang mana satu. Macam saya terus terang saya adalah pengguna Drive yang sangat, sebelum saya mengenali Drive, saya dulu adalah banyak sangat pendrive di tangan saya. Pendrive, ada pendrive ini, pendrive data, pendrive sekolah, pendrive peribadi, pendrive gambar. Lepas tu saya beli hard disk. Masa tu saya tak kenal Google Drive. Okay. Dan selain daripada tu, saya juga adalah pengguna tega untuk Google Classroom. Jadi dua ini merupakan expertise saya lah. Saya sangat. Jadi kalau kita tengok, cikgu tengok, cikgu rasa lah cikgu ni pengguna yang mana satu. Adakah cikgu ni menggunakan semua produk Google? Sebenarnya kita kenal Google ni, cikgu hari-hari guna Google. Paling paling teruk pun adalah, apa orang cakap, Google for Education. Untuk Google for Education ni paling paling lah Gmail. Paling paling teruk lah Gmail. Saya rasa cikgu pakai Gmail. Nak daftar Shopee cikgu, nak daftar YouTube cikgu. Semua benda yang cikgu nak daftar tu mesti cikgu gunakan Gmail cikgu. Sama ada cikgu nak gunakan Gmail peribadi cikgu ataupun Gmail MOE cikgu. Okay. So kalau kita tengok di sini kelebihan dia, ini antara kelebihan. Kalau kita tengok apa yang cikgu pakai, cikgu biasa dengar tak ada 51. Dulu kita dikenali dulu pernah tu dikenali sebagai 51.0. Sekarang ni 52.0. Di mana merupakan adalah Google Workspace for Education yang Malaysia adalah negara pertama di Asia yang menggunakan keseluruhan dalam sistem KPM kita. Jadi rugi tau cikgu, KPM kita bayar banyak untuk produk ni tapi cikgu tak guna. Okay, so gunalah cikgu sebab kita diberikan secara percuma. Okay, kalau tak cikgu boleh tengok kalau cikgu tengok nanti dekat site Google tu, nanti cikgu boleh nampak benda tu kalau nak dibeli, boleh tahan juga harganya. Okay, pelantar yang sangat sangat open dan uniform. Okay, ia tidak perlu, macam mana nak cakap, aplikasi pihak ketiga, third party tu, dalam delima kita tu ada banyak third party atau banyak apps di dalam kita boleh guna. Okay. Dan untuk pengetahuan semua, sebenarnya di Malaysia ni kita lebih kurang ada 5,000 Malaysia merupakan Google Certified Educator. Tak kisahlah dia level 1 ke, level 2 ke, dia innovator ke, dia coach ke, tapi kita ada lebih kurang dalam 5,000. So maksudnya majoriti kita ni dah ada pentolehan lah. Dan pentolehannya yang lagi bestnya adalah bersifat diiktiraf oleh KPM kita, di mana ia adalah level antarabangsa. Mana nak cari? Okay? So, satu ID untuk semua pentadbir. Kita untuk murid, untuk pihak pentadbir. Jadi, saya rasa benda ni, cikgu tahu tak yang mana satu ni ID delima cikgu? Kalau cikgu bermula huruf G, kalau murid bermula huruf M, kalau sekolah dia ada sekolah, kalau ada PPD, dia PPD, ada akaun CM. Dan kelebihannya lagi ni sekolah kita ada dibekalkan lagi akaun CM, content manager. Ada 8 akaun CM. Lepas ni nanti saya cerita lebih detail tentang akaun CM tu. Fahamkan ada setengah sekolah tak guna. Sayangnya. Okay. Ini contoh delima 2.0. Paparan dia. Cikgu tengok di sini. Di dalam ni kita ada Google, kita ada Microsoft, kita ada. Tapi hari ini saya fokuskan kepada Google. Jadi cikgu, kalau cikgu tengok, dia macam bersifat peribadi. Macam cikgu punya. Jadi cikgu dalam satu page ni cikgu boleh bergerak ke mana-mana dan sangat mudah lah. Sangat mudah. Okay. Contohlah. Contoh saya punya lah. Okay. Dan seperti yang kita sedia maklum, guru sekarang ni bukan macam guru zaman dulu. Okay. Bukan guru macam zaman-zaman kita dulu. Zaman guru-guru kita dulu. Zaman 60-an, 50-an, 70-an dulu. Sekarang ni, terutama selepas pandemik ni, selepas PKP lagi lah cabaran dia. Rasa macam ada masa kita lebih banyak melakukan tugas pentadbiran. Lepas tu kelas sekarang murid makin ramai, rakyat Malaysia makin banyak melahirkan anak. Satu kelas sekarang ni dah kadang-kadang minimum kita dah, kalau dulu kita satu kelas paling-paling pun nak capai 20 pun susah dululah. Tapi sekarang ni satu kelas boleh cecah 40, 42. Saya mengalami sebab tu saya boleh bercakap. Saya pernah berada di sekolah yang kurang murid. Saya pernah berada di sekolah yang ramai murid. Saya berada di sekolah yang sedang-sedang. Jadi kita tahu. Dan kita memerlukan apps yang boleh akses dengan cepat. Boleh akses sumber. Boleh akses bantuan. Dan kita lagi merupakan adalah keperluan PTPC. Maksudnya banyak produk Google tu dia telah melengkapi keperluan PDPC abad ke-21. Tinggal cikgu pilih je. Cikgu sesuaikan dengan murid cikgu. Cikgu pilih je lah. Cikgu mahir yang mana, cikgu suka produk mana, cikgu nak untuk subjek apa, cikgu nak guna perlebuan mana. Dari cikgu je. Cikgu yang dia adalah seorang cikgu. Okay. So, seterusnya, kenapa Google ni? Saya sangat suka sebab yang pertama saya suka sangat Google ni adalah apabila cikgu mahir, cikgu join, certified educator, cikgu bukan mahir secara surface saja. Cikgu akan mahir untuk diri cikgu lah, untuk kompetensi cikgu. Cikgu akan mahir digital ini. Dan antara produk Google ni, antara yang saya suka adalah yang pertama adalah kolaborasi. Kita tak perlu, bila kita menggunakan produk Google ni, kita tidak perlu takut sudah. Satu slide, kita boleh kerjasama, join sama-sama, ramai-ramai, siapkan slide tu. Maksudnya bukan perlu seorang-seorang kerja, penat lelah seorang-seorang. Kita tak perlu lagi, awak part awak, download, lepas tu hantar balik, lepas tu betulkan edit, hantar balik, upload balik, download balik. Tapi kalau berasi dalam produk-produk Google ni, kita boleh bekerja dalam, walaupun kita tak bersemuka, tapi kita still boleh menghasilkan kerja-kerja kita sama-sama. Security, dia memang melindungi privacy pelajar dan guru. Dan flexibility-nya produk ini, ada yang boleh digunakan secara online dan offline. Jangan ingat hanya online semata-mata. Boleh, ada setengahnya tu boleh digunakan secara offline. Okay? Dan keboleh aksesan tu, maksudnya semua orang boleh. Sangat mudah. Seterusnya, okay, sebab yang ni saya rasa, sekejap eh. Yang ni saya nak terangkan. Sebenarnya admin boleh bagi link ni. Kongsikan link ni. Saya minta admin bagi dekat link dan cikgu boleh. Okay, sekejap eh. Okay, so okay. Cikgu, bila cikgu nak tahu pasal Google for Education ni, pasal produk-produk Google ni sebenarnya cikgu, sangat mudah cikgu. Dekat link yang saya bagi tu, cikgu klik je. Dekat link ni, dekat page ini, cikgu boleh tahu apa saja cikgu nak tahu pasal Google. Okay, contohnya, kenapa cikgu kena ini dalam bahasa Melayu? Sebenarnya bila kita klik memang dia pergi ke bahasa Melayu, tapi cikgu boleh tukar. Kalau cikgu rasa cikgu nak ke dalam bahasa Inggeris, cikgu tukar dia ke bawah. Okay, so cikgu pergi tukar bahasa dia. Okay, cikgu klik dan cikgu pilih English, Global English. So dia akan pergi kepada English lah. Tapi kalau cikgu rasa cikgu nak dalam bahasa Melayu supaya pemahaman cikgu lebih jelas, lebih mudah, kekal dalam bahasa Melayu. So kalau cikgu tengok dekat sini, kenapa kita pilih slide yang saya buat tadi, sebenarnya saya ambil bahannya daripada page ini. Apa produk yang ada, kenapa kita nak pilih Google? Semua ada dekat sini explanation dia. Okay, kita ada dekat sini explanation dia. Okay, Google Workspace apa? Apa yang ada produk dia, Google Chrome ada. Okay. Tapi saya nak fokuskan kepada for educator ini. Okay, bila kita pergi kepada Google, dalam sinilah ada yang kita nak tentang exam tadi. Okay, contohnya kita pergi kepada certification program. Program untuk exam ni, ia dibahagikan kepada dua. Ia dibahagikan kepada, okay, satu tu adalah label satu dan label dua. Cikgu tengok produk tu. Dia panggil untuk produk. Baik, kembali kepada salah. Okay, cikgu tengok dia ada label satu, tak ada label dua. Ini kita panggil sebagai, bahasa Melayunya adalah kepakaran produk lah. Sekiranya cikgu nak ambil label satu dan label dua, ini dikategorikan sebagai kepakaran produk. Sekiranya cikgu nak pakar tentang produk-produk Google. Apa produk-produk Google tu tadi adalah Google Mail, Google Sheet, Google Talk, Google Slide, Google Form, Google, semua yang ada Google. So itu yang dinamakan sebagai kepakaran produk. So cikgu boleh ambil. Tengok di sini, label 1, ya, sijil cikgu dapat tu nanti bertahan 3 tahun, bertaraf antarabangsa, cikgu kena bayar $10. Boleh beli dekat kreatif ataupun cikgu dapatkan cuma-cuma. Gunakan link yang saya bagi nanti, di mana kerjasama di antara CGD, iaitu cikgu juara digital dengan GEG, Google Educator Group. Okay. Ataupun cikgu nak ambil label 2. Label 2 mahal sikit cikgu, $25. Okay. Dan dalam masa yang sama, macam yang saya cakapkan tadi, ada dua lagi, iaitu pekaran profesional. Dalam pekaran profesional ini, dia ada dua. Satu adalah, yang ini adalah coach. Coach ni antara yang barulah. Okay, coach. Jadi jurulatih yang diperakui. Okay, dia coach. Yang kedua adalah penginovasi, new innovator. Dalam bahasa Melayu lah, dalam bahasa Inggerisnya. So cikgu, kita ada empat certified ataupun Google certified educator yang boleh kita ambil lah. Empat label dia. Yang kalau setakat cikgu nak ambil, tetapi sebelum cikgu pergi kepada coach dan innovator tadi, ada satu lagi, iaitu trainer. Tapi trainer mesti lepas dulu level 1 dan level 2. Baru cikgu boleh ambil trainer. Dekat trainer ni, biasanya kalau trainer ni, cikgu join lah mana-mana GEG untuk membantu cikgu untuk mendapatkan trainer cikgu. Sebab dia macam ada advantage sikit kalau ada yang recommendkan cikgu. Itu cikgu kena join GEG. Okay. So di sini juga kita kena sebenarnya cikgu, kalau cikgu jenis yang orang yang suka belajar sendiri, explore sendiri, dalam ni lengkap. Sangat lengkap, di mana cikgu boleh Cikgu boleh belajar sendiri. Dia mulakan dengan minggu pertama, minggu kedua, minggu ketiga. Banyak benda di dalam ni cikgu boleh explore dan cikgu boleh belajar sendiri. Tetapi saya nak tunjuk cikgu dari segi community. Okay, contoh cikgu. Kalau cikgu join, cikgu tengok dekat sini. Peta satu dunia ni cikgu nak cari kumpulan Google terdekat yang ada jurulatihnya yang telah ditauliahkan. So cikgu boleh cari. Cikgu tengok produk-produk berkongsi macam mana. Dia cikgu klik je. Apa cikgu nak belajar. Okay. So contoh saya nak tunjukkan dengan cikgu. Trainer-trainer yang ada di Borneo lah. Sebab kebetulan kita program kita hari ini adalah untuk zone Borneo kan. So kita contohnya kita klik di sini. Cikgu nampak. Cikgu akan nampak ni. Ini food baru dilantik bulan lepas. Ni kita ada Cikgu Lisa CGD 2022. Kila. Ni contohlah ni bahagian Borneo. Cikgu nampak Beaufort, Labuan. Ni. Okay. Ini antara yang berdekatan. Ni nama saya sendiri. Okay, kalau saya klik, cikgu boleh nampak. Kepakaran saya adalah Google Classroom. Okay, so cikgu boleh panggil saya untuk bagi talk pasal Google Classroom. Macam mana saya buat dekat sekolah. Okay. Ini orang-orang di bawah saya. Mereka-mereka ni adalah orang cakap kaki tangan saya yang sangat banyak membantu saya. Cikgu Claudio, Cikgu Hazlin, Cikgu Aronisa, Cikgu Farahin. Nama tak ada ni. Ustaz Zul. Tak ada kat sini. Okay. So, kalau kita perhatikan, bila cikgu klik saja, cikgu akan jumpa geng Sabahan. Kalau geng Sabahan nak cari siapa? Cikgu nak buat ladap untuk sekolah cikgu. Cikgu nak cari siapa yang pakar tentang apa-apa. Cikgu boleh cari. Sekarang ni cikgu sangat mudah. Kita tak perlu nak panggil penceramah datang ke sekolah. Kita jimat bajet, kapal terbang, hotel apa semua. Cari je kepakaran ni cikgu bagi tak diorang bagi talk untuk sekolah cikgu. Untuk bimbing cikgu. Ni cikgu Nadia. Okay, CGT. CGT tahun 2019. 2020, okay. Okay, ini GP cepat. Leader Kota Kinabalu. Ada semua ada di sini. Yang geng Sabahan, yang geng Sarawak. Kalau nak cari yang geng Semenanjung pun tak ada masalah. Ada di sini. Jadi cikgu boleh slow je. Ni antara yang telah, mereka-mereka yang telah ditauliahkan sebagai trainer. Jadi mereka memang mempunyai expertise. Okay, itu contohnya lah. Ini satu kelebihan dia. Kalau cikgu join Google Certified Educator, cikgu dah dapat sampai trainer. Orang cakap. Okay. Seterusnya saya, ini antara pengenalan-pengenalan dia lah. So cikgu boleh explore, cikgu daftar, exam, semua ada dekat sini sebenarnya cikgu. Kita patah balik ya. Okay, dekat atas ni. Nak exam macam mana? Dia ada latihan. Kita nak buat, okay, kalau cikgu nak pilih persijilan tadi, contoh ya, saya bagi satu. Kita pergi kepada level satu. Cikgu mulakan. Semua ada di sini. Semua lengkap. Jadi tinggal cikgu explore saja. Tapi sebenarnya kalau cikgu rasa cikgu tak nak explore, senang je cikgu. Cikgu join mana-mana GEG. Mereka akan terangkan untuk cikgu. Nah, susah hati. Okay? So seterusnya saya akan pergi kepada slide yang seterusnya. Itu pengenalan panjangnya pengenalan. Okay? Okay, seterusnya saya nak berkongsi tentang macam mana saya menggunakan produk Google di sekolah sebagai seorang pentadbir sekolah. Okay. Kita tengok di sini. Saya tunjukkan beberapa saja contoh. Okay. Untuk pengetahuan cikgu, sebelum saya berkecimpung dalam Google ni sebagai seorang trainer yang bertauliah, saya hanya pengguna tapi saya tidak pernah create apa-apa tentang produk Google. Yang saya tahu saya isi GF, orang lain buat. Saya isi soal selidik, orang lain buat. Saya join class untuk classroom, iaitu join class untuk masa kebetulan kelas khusus aku lah. Khusus, aku dulu tu ada satu khusus tentang keempat ke. Saya kena join ke classroom. Saya join tapi saya bukan creator. Saya bukan membuat sebarang produk-produk Google ni yang saya sendiri yang create. Okay. Dan pada masa itu, contoh ini Google Classroom. Pada masa itu saya ingat Google Classroom ni hanya untuk mata pelajaran saja, untuk mengajar saja, untuk saya dan murid saya saja. Tetapi apabila saya explore fungsi Google Classroom ini, saya dapati Google Classroom ni sangat bagus untuk urusan. Apabila saya menjadi seorang penolongkan dan pentadbiran masa itu. Dan kalau cikgu tengok, rakan-rakan semua tengok di sini, macam mana saya menggunakan Google Classroom, bukan untuk subjek sains saya sudah. Kalau subjek sains saya boleh tunjuk banyak kelas saya buat. Tetapi ini saya cuba guna fungsi Google Classroom itu kepada kursus pendabiran. Antara yang famous sangat, yang sekarang ni semua orang tahu, ERPH lah. Itu yang paling famous lah. Kita tak sangka pula, kalau dulu kita tak tahu, kita tak sangka kan Google Classroom tu boleh digunakan untuk menghantar ERPH. Yang kita guna file-file ni. Sekarang ni kita hantar ERPH kita menggunakan Google Classroom. Okay. Itu contohlah. Dan seterusnya macam sekarang ni, apa yang saya buat, di mana saya buat pengurusan sekolah pun, pengurusan kurikulum saya pakai Google Classroom. Pengurusan pentadbiran HEM untuk COCOM, saya guna Google Classroom. Sangat mudah. Dan ia tersusun. Kita boleh buat divider dia. Sangat tersusun. Selain daripada itu, saya menggunakan Google Classroom ni untuk SKPMG. Okay? Saya menggunakan SKPMG. Di mana cikgu-cikgu saya menghantar keberhasilan menggunakan Google Classroom. Siapa tahu penilaian bersepatu tu kan? Cikgu saya hantar keberhasilan guna itu. Cikgu saya hantar standard 4 mereka menggunakan Google Classroom saja. Semua evident tu di hujung jari saya. Kalau ada audit, ada pemantauan, saya tinggal tunjuk klik saja di hujung jari saya. PBD sekolah pun saya gunakan Google Classroom. Jadi itu contohlah Google Classroom. Okay, contoh lain adalah macam saya cakap tadi, saya adalah pengguna Tega Google Drive. Cikgu tengok dalam Google Drive saya di situlah analisis data cup-nya, pentadbirannya, SKPMG-nya, TS25-nya, PLC-nya, transisinya, PIBG-nya, miniaturan panitia. Semua dalam ni. Jadi saya, kalau saya contohlah, saya travelling, tiba-tiba kena minta data, saya tak perlu nak pergi ke sekolah. Saya buka saja Google Drive saya secara online. Saya pinjam laptop adik-beradik saya sebab ada adik-beradik saya pun cikgu. Contoh kalau saya balik Sarawak, tak perlu saya nak bawa laptop. Sebab benda tu sudah ada di dalam drive. Mana saya boleh buka. Saya boleh access benda tu. Jadi saya memang sangat menggunakan Google Drive lah. Okay. Dan Google Drive ni, cikgu faham kunci pun macam kita pakai pen drive dulu lah, macam kita pakai folder dulu. Konsepnya begitu. Cikgu buka satu. Saya mudah lah. Cikgu yang manage sendiri, cikgu nak dalam folder tu ada apa. Dan satu lagi cikgu kena tahu, siapa yang boleh akses, di situlah kita akan nampak link dia. Yang share link tu, cikgu rasa siapa nak sebagai editor, siapa yang sebagai viewer. Cikgu kena faham konsep tersebut lah. Okay? Ini contoh pelaporan yang saya menggabungkan studio. Kata studio, dokumen studio. Di mana cikgu saya pergi keluar berkursus. Ini contoh satu, transisi. Contohnya program transisi itu macam mana guru saya melaporkan aktiviti transisi mereka. Saya pantau, kalau saya tak sempat nak ke kelas, saya boleh pantau. Hanya daripada report tu akan dihantar kepada cikgu satu salinan, kepada guru besar satu salinan, kepada PK satu salinan. Dalam bentuk yang sudah macam ni. Google Form saya gabungkan dengan dokumen studio. Jadi kemahiran ini hanya akan cikgu bolehi sekiranya cikgu cuba untuk mengambil Google Certified Educator dan cikgu akan mahir lah. Cikgu akan dilatih. Contohnya cikgu, atau pemilik curai, cikgu boleh buat laporan kokem, cikgu boleh buat macam ni. Sangat mudah. Cikgu tak perlu buat 2-3 kali. Dan benda tu terus difolderkan dalam drive. Ikut nama cikgu. Tak apa tak hantar laporan lah, cikgu boleh check. Sangat mudah dari segi pengurusan. Itu contohlah Okay, contoh kerja buat saya di sekolah. Saya share sikit je. Kalau nak banyak, ada satu nanti saya akan buat sharing ke Google Effect. Cikgu boleh tengok di situ nanti lah. Join yang itu eh. Sebab pula saya promosi. Okay. Seterusnya adalah macam perkara yang ketiga yang saya nak share di sini adalah nilai tambah untuk seorang pentadbir. Macam yang cakap tadi kan. Ini saya, Herman. Sekarang ni tak perlulah. Sudah sebab apa? Pakai drive je kan? Okay. Cikgu tengok eh. Ini saya punya drive eh. Cikgu tengok saya sudah berada di 75.02 GB. Okay. Kalau saya dah semak beberapa sekolah yang saya pernah pergilah dan sekarang ni sekolah baru saya. Okay. Saya tengok maksudnya belum dibudayakan lagi. Lepas ni SK layangan akan lebih, saya harap cik-cik saya nanti akan menggunakan Google Drive dia secara macam mana GB dia menggunakan Google Drive. Okay, benda ni percuma. Jadi cik, GB tak perlu nak keluarkan apa-apa bajet. Okay, dan satu lagi, maklumat di hujung jari. Pentadbir, GB, pengetua, semua maklumat di hujung jari cikgu tinggal klik saja cikgu. Cikgu tak perlu nak kacau masa cuti cikgu-cikgu lain. Cikgu tak perlu nak pergi cari siapa data apa semua. Sekiranya maklumat itu telah dilengkapkan oleh guru di dalam drive yang cikgu nak, cikgu minta. Dan so di mana mana cikgu teks. Dan satu lagi maklumat itu dalam tak perlu lagi nak cari macam dulu file di bawah meja, ada bawah file di bawah meja panitia, ada file di dalam bilik panitia, ada pusatkan. Tapi kalau dalam drive tu ia sangat, contohlah drive, ia sangat berpusat. Kumpul di satu tempat. Dan penarafan kepada saya. Penarafan contoh eh. Saya bagi satu contoh. Saya dah minta kebenaran tuannya semalam. Tahniah kepada SK Pekalan di LDN Kota Kinabalu. Di sini sebenarnya saya rasa yang perlu dilakukan oleh GEG ataupun Certified Training CGT yang ada sekarang. Yang ada kita tentang tinggi ni sekarang. Sekarang yang saya rasa boleh kita main peranan sekarang adalah kita pergi racun dulu guru besar dia. Kalau kita dapat kasih racun guru besar dia, kita racunkan satu sekolah. Istilahnya lah. Okay, macam escape pengalaman di LDM kota kita, kita baru ni. Kebetulan GB dia adalah leader. Okay, leader Kota Kinabalu dan dia merupakan di bawah kami sebelum ini merupakan produk di CTP percuma daripada voucher mereka ni percuma yang diberikan oleh di CTP. Okay, dan cikgu tengok dia dapat googlekan satu sekolah dengan sebenarnya sebenarnya cikgu cepat mula-mula dulu cikgu cepat fikir satu di sekolah tersebut, fikir pentadbiran. Tetapi cikgu cepat, guru besar yang lama pun menyokong sebenarnya. Cuma takdir tu sebab voucher tersebut tamat pada 30 Jun. Jadi ada separuh lagi daripada guru-guru ini tidak sempat untuk menduduki peperiksaan dan tidak sempat mendapatkan voucher percuma tersebut. Tetapi alhamdulillah apabila CJD telah berkumpul di Kuala Lumpur hari tu, yang kumpulan CJD yang baru-baru ni. Saya rasa saya nampak Cikgu Nadia ada share gambar baru-baru ni. Masa silap dia tu dia ada share. Di mana Google dan iTrade telah percaya, mereka telah percaya mendapatkan daripada Google dalam 3,000 voucher. Jadi masa tu lah Cikgu Lauren, CGD, juara CGD kita yang pertama, Cikgu Lauren, dia sangat bijak mengatur strategi. Joint venture dengan GIT Kota Kinabalu, kebetulan guru besar SK Pengkalan di LDM. Mereka bekerjasama. GIT Kota Kinabalu melatih. Dan Cikgu Lauren juga turut melatih. Dan Cikgu Lauren, Cikgu nampak Cikgu Jebat menggunakan Cikgu Lauren untuk mendapatkan voucher percuma untuk cikgu-cikgu SK Pekalan TLDM. Sekali lagi saya cakap, kalau kita boleh dapat free, kenapa kita nak bayar? Tahniah sekali lagi untuk Cikgu Jebat dan warga SK Pengkalan TLDM. Dalam ni dia ada geng-geng yang saya kenal. Yang geng-geng di CTP. Contohnya macam Cikgu Suzy tu. Saya kenal tu. Kami antara yang awal-awal yang kami harap mereka dapat jadi trainer. Dan akhirnya mereka dapat jadi trainer. Dan bila mereka jadi trainer, mereka memberikan impak kepada sekolah. Ini yang kita nak. Okay? Itu maksudnya. Dan penarafan ini boleh menyebabkan sekolah cikgu, penerapan kendiri sekolah cikgu dari segi digital, automatically lah cikgu telah melayakkan 100% sekolah cikgu mendapat sijil Google yang bertaraf antarabangsa yang diiktiraf oleh KPM. Okay. Seterusnya. Okay, Google Educator Group. Ini, okay, saya tak nak cerita panjang. Saya rasa semua orang tahu apa fungsi komuniti satu tempat, tapi GEG Educator Group ni kami bantu dari segi produknya Google dan kami membantu kefasihan dalam digital lah. Okay, so ini antara geng-geng kami. Okay, dan Cikgu Azizul ni, okay, saya terus pergilah. Okay, cikgu tengok di sini. Ini Google Satu Malaysia, GEG Satu Malaysia yang ada. Boleh tick not mana satu, dan kalau cikgu tengok, saya fokuskan ada GEG yang berada di Borneo. Kalau cikgu perhatikan di sini, GEG yang berada di Borneo ni, sekarang ni di Sabah, kita ada GEG Lahadatu, kita ada GEG Keningau, GEG Tenom, GEG Kota Kinabalu, GEG Beaufort. Kita ada 5 GEG sudah. Jadi itu saya mengharapkan guru-guru, pengetua, guru besar yang berada di kawasan-kawasan yang berdekatan ini, rebutlah peluang. Gunalah mereka ini untuk memfasihkan digital sekolah masing-masing. Dan di Sarawak sekarang, alhamdulillah, daripada satu je dulu, kita ada GEG Santubong saja dahulu. Sekarang ni kita sudah ada 3. Soon mungkin ada 2. Kita ada GEG Limbang, dan kita ada GEG Serian, dan GEG Santubong lah yang paling lama. Kita ada sebenarnya GEG lain sebelum kewujudan GEG ini. Tetapi GEG yang sebelum ini sudah kurang aktif, dan kami pun tidak dapat mengesan keaktifan mereka macam mana. Yang aktif lah, ini saya maksudkan yang aktif, bukan saya menidakkan yang GEG yang lain lah. Ini yang kami tahulah, yang kumpulan-kumpulan yang kami sentiasa berhubung. Kalau cikgu nak minta bantuan, memang bolehlah. Dan satu-satunya di Labuan, GEG Labuan lah. Labuan tak perlu banyak GEG, cukupkan satu. Okay. Inilah kumpulan-kumpulan yang cikgu boleh cari. Cikgu Hana, GEG Keningau. Okay. Cikgu Azizu, GEG Tenong. Cikgu Hidayah, GEG Buffon. Dan mereka ni mempunyai kapten-kapten, co-leader-co-leader yang sangat bagus. Jadi cikgu boleh jemput, boleh panggil secara online, secara hybrid, gunalah kepakaran mereka ini. Okay? Itu yang saya nak. Macam mana cikgu nak join? Senang saja cikgu. Cikgu daftar je dengan kami, mana-mana GEG. Cikgu join kami, join Telegram kami, join Facebook kami. Kami semua ni ada Facebook ni. Facebook GEG Serian, GEG Limbang, semua ada. Cikgu join je kami. Di situ cikgu akan, cikgu perlukan bantuan cikgu PM saja. Okay? Okay, format ujian. Kita bercakap tadi pasal saya ada masa berapa minit lagi, eh? Okay, ada lagi. Okay, format ujian. Untuk macam saya tadi cakap, level 1 dengan level 2, kita yang ini yang paling basic lah. Sekiranya cikgu belum ke tahap yang trainer, cikgu ambil dulu level 1. Level 1 dan level 2. Dan format exam ini, dia ada 35 question. 35 soalan. Cikgu nak tahu, cikgu sangat bertuah sebab format ini telah bertukar bulan 9 tahun lepas. Format baru ni sangat senang untuk lulus. Sangat senang untuk lulus. Berbanding format lama yang ada senario yang cikgu kena buat dia punya tutorial. Dan saya nak bagi tahulah, saya masa yang mula tu, level 1 saya lulus, level 2 saya gagal. Lepas tu, saya ambil lagi sekali. Bayar. Saya dapat mula, saya dapat voucher percuma. Tapi yang voucher percuma saya tu gagal. Saya bayar, saya ambil lagi. Cikgu sekarang ni bertuah. Ada voucher free, ambil cikgu. Peluang yang ada. Okay, saya gagal. Sebab ada senario tu, saya tak cukup masa. Bukan tak tahu, saya tak cukup masa. Sebab 3 jam. Tetapi soalan objektif 35 masa ni, insyaAllah cikgu cukup masa. Paling lama cikgu ambil pun 1 jam. Berdasarkan rekod kami, yang masa di CTP 5,000 voucher tu, paling lama lah 1 jam. Ya? Dan masa dia 3 jam cikgu, jangan buang masa lah. Maksudnya, jangan cikgu tak perlu rushing lah. Dia ada 3 jam masa cikgu. Dan ini bentuk soalan dia cikgu. Ini contoh soalan first choice. What do your student use when working at research project? Dia akan cakap dekat sini cikgu. Please select 2, please select 1, please select 3. Cikgu ikut arahan dia. Arahan soalan tu. Kalau dia cakap 2, cikgu tanda 2. Kalau dia cakap 1, cikgu tanda 1. Atas sekali ni merupakan bilangan soalan tu. Ini contohnya, ini soalan pertama daripada 35. Cikgu ada reset, ada skip, ada review letter dekat bawah ni. Nanti biasanya benda ni, kami geng-geng GEG, Google Group tu akan terangkan dengan cikgu sebelum cikgu nak exam. Jangan risau, kami akan bantu. Sebab tu cikgu join GEG group tu. Okay. Ini contoh soalan seterusnya. Multiple choice juga. Biasanya kalau soalan tu hanya please select one, dia akan dalam bentuk bulat cikgu. Kalau cikgu nampak, dia bulat. Tapi sekiranya cikgu soalan tu dia minta 2 atau 3. Okay. Sekiranya 2 atau 3, so cikgu akan bentuk pilihan jawapan tu dia tak bulat, dia akan segi 4. Okay, seterusnya. Drag and drop question. Okay, ni yang sebab itu tidak digalakkan cikgu menggunakan cikgu tidak digalakkan menggunakan handphone semasa exam. Sebab soalan ini yang cikgu kena drag, letak di bawah. Okay, send email. So cikgu tahu send, contohnya pilihan yang kedua ni send email. Cikgu kena letak. Harus pergi bawah Gmail. Drag your answer here. Jadi cikgu tak boleh guna handphone. Sebab itu cikgu mesti guna laptop. Okay? Okay, seterusnya. Ini soalan drag and drop. Okay, ini soalan drag and drop juga, tapi dia bukan drop ke bawah peta. Ini soalan drop dia diturun, dia suruh susun. Ini bentuk-bentuk soalan dia. Dan terkini, bulan 6 tahun ini, ada satu tambahan soalan baru, true and false. Kita rasa soalan true and false macam senang, betul salah kan? Tapi soalan true and false ni lah yang memerangkap. Soalan yang memerangkap tak? Sangat susah. Itu antara bentuk-bentuk soalan dia. 35 soalan. Cikgu buat je. Sangat mudah cikgu. Join GEG. Cikgu join GEG. Cikgu akan dapat bimbingan. InsyaAllah sampai lulus. Okay. Seterusnya. Okay, permohonan voucher. Ini dah sampai yang terakhir. Okay, ini yang dah terakhir. So, admin tolong share Google Form yang saya dah sediakan. Dan cikgu isi Google Form ini. Okay. Ini slide yang terakhir dah. Okay, cikgu isi Google Form. Sekiranya cikgu berminat untuk mendapatkan voucher, cikgu berminat untuk mendapatkan voucher free untuk level 1. Okay. Cikgu isilah. Okay. Isi. Nanti kita akan kalau tak, dekat hujung tu, hati-hati ya cikgu. Rakan-rakan yang sudah mengisi, di hujung tu ada, sekiranya cikgu dah isi Google Form ni, cikgu kena, kalau cikgu nak join untuk bimbingan seterusnya, cikgu klik join Telegram. Supaya kita boleh bimbing cikgu dengan lebih lanjut lagi lah lepas ni. Macam mana cikgu boleh mendapatkan certified Google Certified Educator. Okay, so macam mana berkobar-kobar lah nak join. Okay, saya harap semua dapat memahami apa yang saya kongsikan hari ini dan terasa termotivasi untuk join kami ke. Okay, dan saya rasa itu saja daripada saya. Sekian, terima kasih.
Coding was first introduced to me by my swimming coach, Miss Irene Hisham. She was the one who was explaining about coding to my parents and recommended QT kits to them to enroll me to start my coding journey. My dad, who was very keen with her explanation, came home and talked to me about it. Me, who really likes to play games and spend a lot of time on my laptop, said yes and thought it was a very good idea because it will help me in my future to code or create my own game or website.
My favorite part about coding is when I get to test the project I have made so I can see it's either successful or unsuccessful. And if it's unsuccessful, I could improve my troubleshooting skill too.
Yeah, I will use it for my future career maybe so I can like be really good at coding than most country or university want to accept me as their coder, or maybe I can help people edit their photos or, you know, code new games and post it on the app store, and then people will like my game and I'll become more popular.
Our vision is to discover an individual's passion and turn it into sustainable skills. Therefore, we have catered to curriculum best fit for kindergartens, primary and secondary school students. We shall learn and master future-ready skills such as artificial intelligence, robotics, coding, 3D modeling, and so on.
Red. Orange. Yellow.
In future, most of the job will be replaced by robots, machines and software. Here comes questions. Will robots take over humans? Definitely no. But we must undergo a transformation, reshape education and reform ourselves. We foster the unique individualities and self-assurance of each student, equipping them to take on the world with our genetic philosophy, one patient's infinite future.
A very big thank you to Cikgu Sham earlier for sharing about the Google Education Educator Program. It was a fantastic and very engaging session, and a lot of the teachers and the educators we saw on the chat box has been very busy, you know, complimenting Cikgu Sham. So fantastic. Well done, Cikgu Sham. Tanya. We're moving on to the next session right now, and is with Associate Professor Technologist Dr. Norman, who is currently the Deputy Director of Instructional Technologies of the Center for Teaching and Curriculum Development, University Kebangsaan Malaysia, UKM, and currently drives the e-learning transformation in the university. He is also an associate professor at the Faculty of Education, and his research interest is in the field of digital and futuristic education. Wow. He is and has been awarded an international certification by Apple as an Apple Distinguished Educator and Apple Professional Learning Specialist for his involvement in educational transformation at primary, secondary, and higher education levels. He's also a certified professional technologist of the Malaysian Board of Technologies and has been previously appointed as a director on the board of directors with the International Association for Blended Learning, which pioneers blended learning initiatives around the globe. Now, without further ado, let's welcome this very distinguished associate professor. Dr. Norman, thank you for being here with us today.
Thank you for the invite. Awesome.
Great. So on behalf of Synapse and MDAC, I would like to say a big thank you for again making your Sunday evening, spending your Sunday evening with us today, actually, and imparting a lot of knowledge. I obviously did the roll call, fantastic background, fantastic roles that you play in the university and beyond that as well. So I'm sure the sharing session that is going to happen in a short while will be benefiting a lot of our viewers today. So without further ado, I'm going to disappear and the whole stage is yours. Go ahead, Dr. Norman.
All right, thank you. For the organizers, MDAC and also SNAPS, awesome. Thank you again for the invitation. And hi, everybody online today with us today, this Sunday afternoon. Okay, so the talk I will be talking about today is iOS mobile app ideation using iPad. So I'm Dr. Helmi Norman from the University of Malaysia, Malaysia, at the Center for Teaching and Curriculum Development, and I'm also an Apple Distinguished Educator. All right, so ideating your app. So this is a concept, usually when you want to develop an app on iOS, on the Apple, on the App Store, an Apple ecosystem. So there's actually a book that you can download. It's from Apple, Everyone Can Code App Design Journal. So do scan the bit.ly there and you can download the App Design Journal from the QR code there. Okay, I'll give you a link later and you can pause on that and you can download the resources from the Everyone Can Code App Design Journal. Okay, so in the journal, it shows four phases of development of an iOS app. So first you start with brainstorm and there are three steps there. So where you go to purpose, ideas, and focus, and then you go on to plan, and then prototype and also evaluate. So we'll go to these four phases today and develop a prototype app. And then, when you have an idea of developing an app, so it's good to have the plan, have the prototype, and then provide the ideas to the programmers, app developers. Then they will understand your ideas for that. But this is a great book. I recommend you to download it. It's free and you can use it to develop iOS apps. All right. Okay. So today what we're talking about is relating to United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. So 17 SDGs here. And what we'll be tapping is today I'll be choosing one of the SDGs, which is Sustainable Cities and Communities, which is SDG number 11. So, and I will be zooming on the problem of sustainable transport here in the SDG number 11. Okay, so I'm going to show you the I'll be showing you the journal here. Okay, so this is the journal. Okay, and I've filled it up with a few things that we'll be discussing before we go on to the app. All right, so again, going to brainstorm, plan, prototype, and evaluate. So the first phase is brainstorm. So here you have to define the purpose. So there's a few checkpoints here, a list of opportunities. So but this one is I didn't do this for the car app, but it's for another app. It's called a smart classroom app, but this gives you a guide into that. So for instance, there's no technology in the classroom, so in the learning spaces done for active learning, for instance, but for the car, maybe there's a problem with pollution, there's problems with transport, and it's not sustainable enough. And we're running out of petroleum resources. So these are the problems or challenges that we want to state in the beginning to sort of define what the problem is to lead to the solution. So here I've shown you about the smart car builder. So this is a smart class build app, and in the smart car. So for the smart car, you will have to, you know, sort of go through your ideas and which you know, focus on, and then going to plan, sort of going to your user actions, what users will click there, and then user input, and then for instance, you know, tap on a location. Of course, we will go through this as I show you the app. And here you have a lot of things that you know, on the iOS, what the iOS app can provide to you. You know, for instance, for cameras, we use the gyroscope, we use the accelerometer, machine learning, any haptics on your iOS device. So going there and probably having inclusivity in your app, and then going to the third phase, which is prototype. So here maybe sketching something and going through the storyboard. So I think this is important before you actually develop an app, and then putting some icons, definitely, I think, very important in development. So I think what differentiates apps from, you know, a iOS app and a mobile app is, I think, is the icons. Yeah, I think these are important. Using more icons represent an app, and maybe, you know, decreasing on the text a bit. Yeah, and then moving to Keynote, using that, and probably the icon's name, and then and for the final phase, having that to evaluate. Having that prototype to be tested by the user. So I think definitely have to take on this app journal, and it's lovely to go through this process. Okay, let's go to the fun part, which is the app demo. So this is my smart car builder app demo, and I'll just give you a sorry. All right, okay. Wrong slide. Okay, so smart car builder app demo. So here, I'll give you 1 minute to download the resources here. So you can go to bit.ly/digitalmaker-eastcoast, or you can scan the bit.ly code there. And here are some models that I took from sketchfab.com. So here are the, sort of CC or Creative Commons attribution to the resources that I'll be using in this demo. All right, okay. So I hope everybody got that, and hope the organizers can copy paste that one and put it in the chat box to for the participants to do along. All right, so. Again, this is the app, right? So I'm gonna click start here, and then the smart car builder app will be asking, what type of car are you looking for? So I want to save the planet, so I want to go full electrical. I want to save time, but I want to use some petrol sometimes. So you to have the option of electrical car and also the hybrid car. So we're going electrical car here, and so this is the smart EV 2022, and then these are the specifications of the car, and then you have the option for going next to choose the car features, or you can go, you know, 3D view of the car, and then let's have the 3D view of the car here. Right, awesome. Okay, so I'll show you how to do that in a jiffy. Very easy to use, but again, I'm using the resources from cashgrab.com, and thank you for the developers that have the 3D model. Okay, and next, choosing the...
To ensure your car is safe, you can install the automatic braking system.
Okay, so there's a explanation there, which I will show you in a bit, but again, that's using Memoji, so I'll show you in a bit how to create that on the iPad or the iPhone. So you can do that, replace your face with an emoji, and then, you know, sort of have that different interaction for the users. to go there. Yeah, so you can you do that too. All right. So now for the next feature is smart parking. Okay, and then lastly, we want the this is the second last. We have CarPlay, and then you know if you want CarPlay, so you have this.
Introducing Apple CarPlay, the app that makes your car smart. Now you can use it to navigate roads and use Apple Maps.
So here's the navigation here, and I'm not gonna play the audio, but again, here now Apple has introduced Apple CarPlay. It's so awesome. It was only available on Tesla before, but now it's a lot of cars are using it now. The new one. I think in the CRVs have them, and the Toyota RAV4 have them too. HRVs also. So CarPlay, a very awesome thing. You can connect with your phone and then link to your car, and then everything is smart, right? Okay, so let's install that, and let's explore the different colors of the car, right? Okay, so let's explore that. And not a red. I don't want the red car. I want the green one. So yeah, you can change the colors there. So blue. And then maybe I'm going to go for the red. So let's go back to the red one. And then so I choose red and show my car. So let's see the car in augmented reality. Awesome. How big is it? So this is what we can do in ideation. Of the app. So let's do the video here and then see. So here at the hotel, so this is in the middle of the night. So I was like, where am I going to shoot this car? So I just did a augmented reality of the car, and I so it fits in the hotel, right? The hotel corridor. So this is the car that is my prototype. So this is good to show the actual spatial awareness and spatial the physicality of the car. It looks look and feel, how it looks in 3D, the space, the the size. All right, so yeah, cool. And augmented reality, awesome. So this is really easy to create on the iPad, which I will run with you in a bit. Okay, cool. So this is the smart car builder app. So I'm gonna go through a few steps that we're gonna go and go deeply into the walkthrough of how I did the mobile app, right? Okay, mobile app prototype. Okay, so for the first one, for the first step, what I did is I chose, I wanted the users to choose a type of engine. So whether it was electrical or hybrid, so this was the interface that I showed to you. And how did I do this? So first of all, I chose the I gave the option of the electrical car, and then I gave the option of the hybrid car. Okay, so and how did I do that? So I used Keynote, the app used to develop, and so let's go and have a look at how I did it on the iPad. So open Keynote there. It's a native app, free on the iPad, and choose a theme. So I choose the white one, the black one, sorry. And then what I did is, added a new slide. So what I did is press plus on the right. So to add photos, to add videos, you can do that. And I added a iPhone screen, right? So because it is a mobile app, that will run on the App Store. So you want that. And then I screenshot. So I took the shot from augmented reality. So from Reality Composer, and took a screenshot of the car. And what I did is here, I removed with Instant Alpha. Now the new interface is called Remove Background. So you want that. Awesome. You have the car image as your for the splash page or for the first page of your app, right? So now moving on, you want to add a shape which will serve as a button. So adding plus, and then when you press the paintbrush or the brush icon, you can change the color and fill it with the color that you want as your line, as your button. So this one, I'm going to put it up as a line, so as an animated line before the button comes out. So again, so now I'm positioning the line there, right? And up next is, so you want to position, so you can arrange that by pressing paintbrush, arrange, and then moving back to front. So as you can see there on the right, so I'm moving it back to front there. And now the line is at the back of the car. We don't want the line to be there. And then now adding another shape, which is the button at the on the app, right? So I've added it's still the animation, actually not the button yet. But so adding that as the animation, and then I will be adding another text. Okay, so again pressing plus, and then pressing so when you press plus, you want to add something, and when you press paintbrush or brush, you want to format or you want to change something. You want to edit the feature, you want to edit the colors, you want to add the font. So that's where you get the features to be implemented. So here, I'm going to put the text and then changing the font. So changing the font to to a different font. And there's a lot of things that you can do here on the app. And let me just quickly go through, and then so here we got the bold, so you can sort of change the size, color, the size of the font, the font size. And then here and then adding another button there for and arranging that. So a lot of things. I think Keynote is very powerful in this aspect to sort of develop that prototype looking good there. Okay, so I'll just quickly grab to, okay, so here I think moving towards good contrast is important. So if you have red, probably the text is white, so to have the contrast there and to look having that legibility, I think is important. So again, add a new slide. So add a new slide, just press plus here and then go to blank or any other template. So we can also duplicate that so to have that there. And if you want, so I have another picture here which I did, and putting that animation as well there, so and having that interface there. And I think this is important here, how to add functionality. So what you want to do is link it up, so link it to the next slide or the first or previous slide. So I think this is important to actually show the app to the developers later, right? Okay, cool. So now what we want to do is we're going here to this let's go car 3D view, and this one is the green one. So I didn't show you the, so how did I create that 3D car spinning, right? So the app that I use is Reality Composer, and again, developed by Apple, very powerful software, very powerful app to develop your own augmented reality. So you can model that. You can model 3D models, which I don't have time for to show you today. But I will just be taking some models, external models from sketchfab.com. Just plugging in Reality Composer, and I think very powerful software. So do install it on your iPad, on your phone, and very powerful software for creating AR. So let's have a look on how I did that in Reality Composer. So on your iPad, have that downloaded from the App Store, Reality Composer, and then pressing plus to create a new project. All right, so you will have a couple of anchors. So what we choose is horizontal. You can have different anchors there. Okay, so I think I'll show you a bit about the anchors. I'll just stop there. I think this is important. Okay, so you have a couple of options. So you can have the plane augmented reality on a horizontal surface and on a vertical one. So if you want, you know, like a spider climbing on the wall, or you want a painting on a wall, also you can have it on vertical and horizontal. You can have it in a flat surface, but I think image is awesome as well. You can use like the textbooks or the books or magazines, so you want an image to go out from that. You can use image there, and also face recognition if you want your face to have these hats or the mask, then you can have that as well. All right, so in Reality Composer, so what you want to do is delete that and delete that as well. So the circle there is actually the center of the universe. So very important to have that navigation, because augmented reality is very big. So if you lose the center, it's going to be hard for you to navigate. So ensure that you have the center of the universe there. All right. And what I did is I added this I added this 3D model by pressing plus, and then you could add that there. All right. So I'm going to add that by pressing plus, which is there. Right. And all right, so when I added that to the a Reality Composer, so you can spin it with your fingers to make it in 3D, 2D, and then and when you press AR, so you can view that straight. You know, it's like adding the object straightforward. You can put it in AR and actually use the space to see the model in action in the real environment. So augmented reality allows for us to use digital objects and then place them in the real world and see the actual position. So I think very powerful software, Reality Composer.
To ensure your car is safe, right, you can install the automatic braking system.
When you see the emojis, I'm replacing myself with a virtual avatar or virtual character. So I'm using clips. I was just showing you how to use that. But to develop that, you have to go to messages first. And on messages, if you have an iPad or an iPhone with face recognition. So I think that's important, because it wants to recognize your face. So go to messages and then create a new message and tap on the icon, which has the one with hearts, and then press new Memoji, and then here you can knock yourself out. If you want it to resemble you, you can do that. If you want it to resemble different characters, you can do that. Change the hairstyle, change the brows, eyes, skin. So this is what you can do on messages, on the using messages, right? Okay, so once you have that, you can knock yourself out with this. I'm putting some glasses on the avatar, and voila. So that's good to go. All right, so now what I'll be doing here is here I'm going to clips. So this is the other software. So here, pressing star there and using that emoji there that I was, that I was creating on messages, so now I can use it on clips, using that with gestures. It's in real time, so it's very powerful software to use images. And then when you have finished, recording yourself, you can save a video and use that in iMovie or another editing software or video editing software that you want. All right. Okay. So for the automated smart parking. So this, I did that that animation on Keynote. So So for the two cars, so hybrid Go and also the other red car. So here. This one was I actually use iMovie and also GarageBand to sort of create this.
Introducing Apple CarPlay.
Okay, cool. Now, how to guide using iMovie and GarageBand. I'm not gonna be able to show you on GarageBand, but let me just see. Okay, let me. Okay, it's okay. Yeah, it's okay. Don't worry about it. Okay, so this is a software which I will show you without sound. Okay, I'll show you this because I'm using it. I'm using iPod, so you won't be able to hear any sound. But again, I'll just show you how to do it. Straightforward. So you can use live loops or tracks. But what I'll be using is the house. And when I'm pressing some buttons, so just knock yourself out. I mean, it's very powerful. So you can use instruments on the left here, and then you can just press some buttons here, and then music will automatically go out, and you can position, beats there, and you compose your own music. So it's not just about, taking audio from YouTube, because when you post audio on YouTube, there'll be like copyright. Right, you can't use my music. So I think this is very powerful way to actually create your music, compose your own music on GarageBand. Very powerful software. So go and have a look on GarageBand. Again, in a native app, free on the iPad. Okay, awesome. All right. So finally, we'll go to the augmented reality software. Okay, so this is the smart car. I didn't show you how to do that. Okay, so let me show you in a jiffy on how that is done. All right, let me hook my iPad up to my Mac. So now this is my iPad, and so swipe and go to Reality Composer, right? So Reality Composer, very powerful software. Again, I think I've shown you. So, but again, this is how I did it. Again, horizontal. Deleting that because they want to show the center of the world. So you can import external objects, or you can sort of use the objects inside. So I'll just show you one of the things that is here. Let's say house. Alrighty. Okay. So. Okay. So here we have the house. Voila. Right. And all right. I'm gonna use augmented reality, but not so good. Okay, so here I'll just quickly. Okay, let me move some stuff. So I have to move some stuff. Okay, so I have to move some stuff to be able to use augmented reality. Okay, cool. All right, so I see AR straight away. Yeah. And you can see that my house is too big. Let's scale it down. Okay. So now here, as you can see here, on my table is the house. Oh, okay, awesome. And you can actually make it bigger and scale it down too. So awesome augmented reality here. But actually, what you can do is actually you can change the type. So it looks, you know, you have the variant here. And then you have the width. You want it to be 3 floors, 4 floors, you name it. And then actually it has the scale. You know, you can scale up big and it looks like an actual house that you're going to. So I think this is very powerful software. Again, do try that. So this is how you do it in AR, right? So again, the circle is very important. That's the sensor. So if you want to import any, you know, models from outside, no problem. So I have some pretty cool Sketchfab models here. So probably car. Where's that car? Okay, so I have that car. All right, so okay. You can do that, right? Put the car there. Voila, easy, straight away. Right, but I won't be able to show you how to model this. But I can just show you how it can be run on augmented reality. Ooh, big car. So you just get it down here, right? It's on my table, right? Awesome, pretty awesome, right? So now what I can actually do is put this car in a island, right? So if you have these, if you have an island here, let's try this one. Okay, I saw this one. So, oh my god, this is cool. Tropical island, let's do this. Let's use this. And then wow, you can put that, you know. So I have the tropical island here, and I'm gonna scale the car a little bit down, put it up there. And what is this car doing on this island anyway, right? It's kind of floating there, no problem. So floating it down, right? Cool. Okay, now all right, cars going good. All right, so maybe, yeah, so you can use that. You know, I'm pressing on this red green buttons because I'm changing the XYZ. So you know, you have the car there. Awesome. Okay, let's try that in AR. Oops, lazy. All right, so I have the car here, right? Ooh, okay, this is my car and I'm in the beach there, on the beach. All right, so I have some there. And I actually can walk here, right? So awesome, right? Augmented reality. So this is not augmented anymore. This is actually virtual reality. But again, awesome software that is very powerful software that you can use in on your iPad. Very powerful stuff there, right? Okay, so to sort of summarize and you know, sort of summarize and recap everything that we did. So again, to call everybody, let's together start creating your iOS app. I did the iPad today. Very powerful things that you can do. I think everybody can create an app, even though you don't know programming, no problem, because there's two parts of app. I think first is the ideation part or the creative part, and then the idea part. So I think this is very important because sometimes programmers know how to program, but they don't know what to do program. So what do you want on your app? You want the smart car builder. How does the smart car look like? Is it green? What features do you want? Do you want a gyroscope there? Do you want the car to be red? Do you want that? So I think it is important for you to sort of ideate your idea and propose that to, you know, show that to the developer, and then they can code at that for you. So I think it's a cool way to actually go for the user, you know, experience, user interface, how do you design the apps, the graphical design, going for that creative route, you can do that. So creative part of the app, content part wise, and then you have the programming, which again, Apple has the Swift code. So that's everyone can create. So this is two curriculums there again on Apple. Downloaded the books for free, so everyone can code. So there's everyone can code video, photo, and then a lot of others. And you have the everyone can code where they introduce you to Swift programming. And then again, so that's for the programmer side. So again, to sort of finalize and open any Q&A, open a Q&A session if possible, and let's together start creating your iOS app idea with iPad today. And if you want to reach me, I'm online, helminorman.com. Follow me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, and I have my YouTube channel, Basama to tell me, so you can have a look at that. All the, you know, tips and tricks, I put it on YouTube, so you can just have a look and, you know, pause. Maybe the session was a bit quick, but I mean, grab the, you know, one-to-one, one by one, you know, step by step, on the YouTube channel. All right. Okay. So, thank you everybody for the talk, and thank you for the organizers. Maybe in Q&A before we wrap it up. All right. Thank you.